Hello and welcome to Data Structures and Algorithms lecture on Multidimensional Arrays. So here let us consider a multidimensional array into picture. So before this, I would recommend you to watch the lecture on linear arrays and then two-dimensional arrays. There are two video lectures which you will require as a prerequisite to watch this video. So let's now get into the video. Okay, now here you can see we will first consider a two-dimensional array. We will first consider a three-dimensional array, right? We have three dimensions here, subscript 1, subscript 2, and subscript 3. So, to identify an element from the linear array, an array LA with three dimensions, we need to specify three different dimensions to identify the element, right? It is very necessary that we know all these three dimensions to identify a particular element. So, a three-dimensional array has three subscripts and n-dimensional array has n subscripts. If there is an n-dimensional array, then we need n subscripts for it. Okay, so we need n subscripts for it. Now, let us consider how to represent the n dimensions. We had earlier represented two dimensions using the size m by n. Now, what is the size of an n-dimensional array? The n-dimensional array, the size of the n-dimensional array is m1 into m2 into m3. What is m1? This is the length of the first dimension, length of the second dimension. So, m1, m2, m3. So, this is how we represent the size of the n-dimensional array. Now, each dimension has an index or the subscript. So that is k. K suffix I. For first dimension it is k1. Second dimension it is k2. Okay. So now the subscript k1 lies between 1 and m1. Okay. The subscript k1 lies between m and m1. This is true for all the dimensions and it extends up to nth dimension. Right. How to represent an element in the array, n dimensional array? We had represented the two-dimensional array element like this. So this identifies the element at the position k1th row and k2th column. Okay. So similarly, here we can represent the element, a unique element in the array by b of k1, k2, etc. up to nth dimension. We need to mention all the n dimensions to identify a particular element here. Now let us see an example to make it very clear. The example here has a 2 by 4 by 3 matrix. Okay, 2 by 4 by 3 array, right? 3-dimensional array. What is this 2? This is the number of rows. Okay, what is this 4? The number of columns. This 3 is the number of pages. Okay, 3 is the number of pages. Right? So, let us now see it very closely. Here you can see the number of rows is 1 and 2. Number of columns 1, 2, 3 and 4. Right? Number of pages is page 1, page 2 and page 3. Is it clear, ma? Okay. Now let us see how we can represent these in the memory. Okay, we can represent these in sequential locations as we had earlier seen. Here also we will see them in sequential locations. They can be represented in two ways, right? Row major order and column major order. What happens in row major order? In row major order, we first go into first row completely, then the second row. So this was easier to visualize in two-dimensional arrays. But now in multidimensional arrays, to keep it easy on your minds, let us visualize an odometer, an automobile odometer that you see in the front dashboard of your automobile. Okay, let us assume it has some 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 digits. Okay, you can see the least significant digit changing rapidly, incrementing rapidly, reaching its upper bound. And then when it reaches its upper bound, the next digit changes by 1. Okay. So this happens in a fashion from right to left. It increases rapidly from right to left. This happens. Okay. column major order exactly does this in an opposite way. Okay, the rapidly changing digit is the most significant bit in the column major order. This is to keep it easy on your minds. This is a very simple tip to keep it easy on your minds. Now let us visualize this in this example. See this in this example. This is a column major order, right? So we start from first row, first column, first page. Okay, column major order. So we try to complete all the columns first. So complete this column, go to the second column. Complete this column, then go to the second column. Complete this column, go to the second. And this is over. Now go to the second page and start with this first column. Okay, complete this column. So this is a column major order in as for an example. This is a column major order. Column major order. Okay, so is it easy now? Okay. So we have seen how to represent it in memory in row major and column major order. Next, let us have a look at how to calculate the length of each dimension. This is very easy and simple, as we have already seen. The formula, as we have seen in linear arrays, it is length is equal to upper bound minus lower bound plus 1. But we have n dimensions. So for the ith dimension, what is the length? We have a length corresponding to each dimension here. Okay, so Li is equal to Ubi plus Lbi plus 1. What is Ubi? Upper bound of the ith dimension. What is Lbi? Lower bound of the ith dimension. So we have a length corresponding to each dimension here. Okay. Now let us see how to find the address of a particular element in n-dimensional array. Okay, the address of a particular element in n-dimensional array. So what is the first step? The first step is to find the effective index. So what is this? It is the effective index. So this effective index has the formula Ei is equal to, this is the ith dimension. For ith dimension, Ei is equal to Ki minus lower bound of ith dimension. Is it clear? Now here is the formula. So base address of B plus W. So this is very similar to the two-dimensional array. So it needs no explanation, I guess. Okay. So now here you will watch it very carefully. So this term is En Ln minus 1 plus En minus 1. This is for the first dimension. You extend it to the second dimension, extend it to the third dimension, and this goes on. Okay. So for n dimensions, we have to accordingly change the formula. Now let us see the row major order. This is very easy as compared to column major, because it starts from n. It is a bit, we have to visualize it. Now here it is very easy on your minds. The row major order involves E1, L2 plus E2. This multiplied by L3. Then this term plus L3, E3 multiplied by L4. So this continues on. Okay, so this is the formula to find the location of a particular element in an n-dimensional array. Now let's take an example to understand it very better. Okay, so don't worry if you are not getting the formulas right. Just look at the example and get back to the formula. It will be easy on your minds. Okay, so this is the example that we are looking at. Maze is a three-dimensional array, and every dimension has a lower bound and upper bound. This is the first dimension. The first dimension has a lower bound 2 and the upper bound 8. The second dimension has a lower bound minus 4 and upper bound 1. So here you can see the length of the first dimension L1 is given by 8 minus 2 plus 1. Upper bound minus lower bound plus 1. Okay. So likewise, we calculate for all the three dimensions, L1, L2 and L3. Okay. So after calculating the lengths, how do I calculate the total number of elements? The total number of elements is given by 7 multiplied by 6 multiplied by 5. So this is 210. This is the total number of elements. Now, we assume that this is represented in a row major order in our given example. Okay, so row major order in our given example. And we have the base address of maze as 200. Okay, W is the words per memory cell, and it is given as 4. Now, what do we find? We should find the address of this particular element, location of this particular element, which is in 5 comma minus 1 comma 8th position, right? So the first step is to find the effective address. What is the effective address EI? EI is equal to KI minus LB. Okay, so E1 is equal to KI. What is KI? KI is this number. KI is this number. Kth element. Okay, the subscript. 5 minus what is the lower bound of the first dimension? The first dimension's lower bound is 2. Okay, so 5 minus 2 is 3. Similarly for E2. E2, the K value is this minus 1. And we have the lower bound is minus 4. So E2 is KI minus of lower bound. So it is 3. So we calculate all the effective indices. After calculating the effective indices, we need to use this formula, this base address formula. So when we are applying this formula, we should first find E1 into L2. Okay. So we are finding E1 into L2. This is 3 into 6, which is 18. Now the next step is we should find E1 multiplied by L2 plus E2. We need to add E2 alone. You add E2 with this and you get 21. Then you need to multiply with L3. So you get 105. After that you need to add with E3. You get 107. So we have only 3 dimensions. So we stop here. Please see this formula. We have only 3 dimensions. So you cannot extend this more than this. Okay. So in row major order, we come up to this and we stop here up to E3, right? Now we have this particular value in our hand. We will add it with base value of B plus W. Okay, so now look at this. I substitute it in this formula. Base address plus W multiplied by this value. This will give the output. So this is the address of the particular element in a three-dimensional array. This can be extended to n dimensions also. Try to work out and find the answer. Thank you.